Also, Martin Duval. Er ist Kultur- und Medienwissenschaftler. Er lehrt an der Amsterdam University for Applied Science. Seine Forschungsgruppe heißt Play and Civic Media. Das klingt irgendwie vergnüglich für mich. Sein Forschungsinteresse richtet sich vor allem auf die Wechselwirkung von digitalen Medien und Stadtkultur, also der klassische öffentliche Raum. Und er nimmt dabei die Gestaltung und die Bedeutung eben dieses öffentlichen Raums in den Blick. Und im November wird er dann hoffentlich Gastgeber sein eines ganz großen Events, nämlich der renommierten Media Architecture Biennale. Wir wünschen Ihnen von Herzen, dass die dann stattfindet, so wie wir heute unsere Veranstaltung eben auch durchführen. Und wir sind jetzt sehr gespannt, was er uns mitgebracht hat an Einsichten, Erkenntnissen, Food for Thoughts. We are absolutely delighted that you are here, Martin, and thanks for coming, and the floor is yours. Zu Ihnen möchte ich noch sagen, Martin Duval wird nicht Niederländisch sprechen, er wird auch nicht Deutsch sprechen, wir weichen auf Englisch aus, aber wenn Sie nachher Fragen an ihn haben sollten, die können Sie ruhig Deutsch an ihn stellen, weil verstehen tut das, er spricht das auch, er will es nur nicht zeigen heute. Vielen Dank, ja, Applaus danke, für Martin.
Ja, vielen Dank für die Einladung hier. It's a great honor to be here. Und ja, ich spreche so ein bisschen Deutsch, aber ich verstehe auch schon, aber ich bin nicht ganz bequem, um so ein Verhaal wie heute ins Deutsch zu reden. So, ich hoffe, dass es für ihr okay ist, dass ich im Englisch rede. So, thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here. Martijn de Waal is my name, University of Applied Sciences in Amsterdam. And the research that we're doing with our group is related to public space in the network society. And in our research, we look both at traditional public spaces in the urban realm and what digital media is doing to those. And we're looking also to online public spaces such as digital platforms. And when Ingrid and I were sparring a few months ago in the lead to the symposium today, we were thinking that it could be perhaps of interest to make a comparison between the two. Sort of what are the important themes or findings from theory on urban public space, and how does that relate to theories on digital public space in the context of platformization. So that's what I'm going to do today. I'm going to talk about urban public space, I'm going to talk about digital public space, and I'm going to look for analogies between them. And I think two that will stand out in my lecture today is first that we can understand both of them through the metaphor of the platform. So both public spaces in the city as well as online are marketplaces, cultural system that connect people in some way or another. However, and that's the second comparison, in both cases, those platforms, those infrastructures, and it's been said before already in your introduction today, they're not neutral. They come with particular values, and the values embedded, they steer our interactions into a particular direction. And having said that, that means, and I think that's the conclusion that I want to leave with today, and I'm already going to give it away, is that that means that it comes with a responsibility. Right? There is a responsibility in the design of platforms, there is a responsibility in the design of urban infrastructures to, as the minister just said, make sure that this technology is serving us as people, serving us as a society, and not just there for the technology itself or only there for the investors. And that's more or less the story. I'm going to start with four chapters, and the first two chapters are about urban public space, and then I move to the media space. So let's take one step back. Why do we talk about public space? Why is it important to talk about public space in cities, in urban societies? And for this, I really, as a starting point to think about this, I have always really enjoyed a quote of this researcher and neighborhood activist, Jane Jacobs, who in the 1960s wrote a very famous book, The Death and Life of Great American Cities. And in that, she gave a very intriguing definition of the city for me. She wrote, "Great cities are not like towns, only larger. They're not like suburbs, only denser. They differ in basic ways, and one of these is that cities are by definition full of strangers, right, think of it. I think that it's sort of a very brief description of what a city is, but I think it's very true, right? If we are in a city, we're continuously surrounded about people that we don't know. We don't know them personally, but we also don't know them categorically, right? They may come from different backgrounds, different cultures, different religions. They have different behaviors. They may speak even different languages. And that's, in a way, the essence of the city, and that's great, right? Because for most of us, that's exactly the reason that we live in cities. Because those people who we don't know, who are strangers to us, who are different from us, they provide also a lot of value to us. They may sell something that we want to buy, or they might want to buy what we are selling. They have a particular expertise or a specialization that we need, or the other way around. We have a very particular specialization, and in the city we find other people for whom that's useful. We find people with whom we share particular interests, etc., etc. So that's really why we are in cities, because of the great variety of people, of services, of cultures, of etc. facilities. But at the same time, that's also terrifying, right? All those strangers, who are those people? Can we trust them? How do we know that they're not going to run away with their money? Are they going to come back tomorrow? Are they really as expert as they say, etc., etc.? So how do we live together? How do we cope in such urban societies? And I think the answer for that has been given by lots of urban scholars, amongst others Manuel Castells, who have theorized actually the city not just as a marketplace where we are able to find the people that we need to connect specializations, to find the people that share the similar interest, but also as a cultural system, a communication system. Manuel Castells wrote about cities as interfaces, or you could even say platforms, communication systems that connect individual and collective identities. And this is expressed, in his view, materially in forms, in rhythms, in collective experiences, and those make cities producers of sociability, integrators of otherwise destructive creativity. So what he means is that actually the system itself is a cultural system that lays out for us as citizens particular histories that we can experience through the architecture, for instance, maybe monuments that are there in the city, etc., but also by particular activities that are organized in particular places of the city that we learn to know through time, the rhythms of the city that we become part of when we sort of are in the flow of commuter going to our work, or when we go on Saturday for shopping, and after a while we start sort of recognizing the patterns that happen. All that, according to him and also other theorists, makes us able to sort of feel ourselves at home in the city and pick out the things that are of interest to us. And Richard Sennett has further theorized that about the role that public spaces have in those processes. He has laid out that public spaces are the places in the city where people allow to learn to live with strangers. It's in the public spaces that we start relating to all those other people that we don't know. And this relation, that relating, that spans a very broad of activities. It can be sort of watching from a distance. It can be maybe sort of a brief encounter, as Jane Jacobs was writing about in her book, in the bakery or at the grocery shop, where you just have a very brief, superficial conversation. Or it can be sort of all the way to the extent that Habermas, for instance, has theorized the coffee houses, where we really sit down and have debates with other people about the future of the city, right? But the public spaces in the city, they facilitate this ability to relate to each other. And for me, another Dutch architect has also been very influential in thinking about the city. She's the architect of Pendrecht. You see a picture behind this, because she basically says the same as what I've said before. For her, she said, the modern city should give men or women a freedom to choose from an endless possibilities. Again, that's why we're there in the city, right? Sort of traditional villages, they're very much limited in what they have offered, but in the city, we have the freedom to choose. However, there's a but, and now it becomes normative rather than departing from sociology. She says, democracy does not allow to withdraw. We are in space and we are part of it, right? So She says that on the one hand, it's great that in cities we can relate to all these strange people, that we can sort of make our own decisions, we can pick what we want, we can select our own little clubs that we want to belong to, our own little specializations that we really like. However, in a democracy, there is always the duty to become part of the collective as a whole. And I think here it's a sort of a in a very brief sort of maybe also the essence of our European sort of social democratic tradition, right? Where as a society, we are as a citizen, you're also responsible for the collective and the society as a whole, which is, I think, very different from the libertarian perspective where you as an individual are mainly responsible for your own life that we found in the logic of many platforms that I will talk about later. But now I'm jumping ahead. I want to go back to this because she took this very seriously and she tried to translate this into the architecture of this neighborhood. And she did that in an interesting way. And I'm just going to give this as an example. This is the layout of the neighborhood. It was built in the 1950s. And you see it was subdivided in 10 little districts. And at that time in the Netherlands was very much a pillarized society. I don't know if that means anything here in Germany, but it means that people in the Netherlands were very much sort of enclosed in their own cultural community, right? You were a Protestant, or you were a Catholic, or you were a socialist. And if you were a Catholic, you would go to the Catholic soccer club, and you would even go to the Catholic butcher, and you would live in a house that was built by a Catholic housing association. So that was the reality that she had to deal with. But in a way, she would probably concur that that would also be the freedom of the city, right? To choose whether you want to be a socialist or a Catholic or a Protestant. So what she did was, in this neighborhood, she gave particular parts of that neighborhood. So for example, this one would be given to the Catholic Housing Association, and the one on the top would be given to the Socialist Housing Association, and the one on the right was given to the Protestant Housing Association, right? So each little corner was a little society in itself. But then, she argued that all the services that they would have used together, they would be in the middle. So number 10 and number 9, so number 10 was where all the shops were, and number 9 was where all the schools were, right? So even though people were living in their own little neighborhoods, they would still be forced through the structure of how she designed it to sort of meet and be connected when they were doing their groceries, when they would bring their kids to school, etc., etc. And I think what is interesting, I think we cannot really repeat, of course, this particular example, but I think it shows a way of thinking about architecture and design that we probably could bring to the 21st century, right? Because when she was talking about her own work, and this is what it looked like in a tradition of modernism that was popular in those days, I was not looking for an aesthetic solution for her. Architecture was not about sort of the sculpture of the buildings, but I was looking for a grid for social relations, right? A platform that would enable the social relations between those different groups. And that was the responsibility that she took as an architect in designing this particular neighborhood. So the summary of this first part, I guess, is that we can understand public spaces as sites where we can learn to feel at home among strangers. We feel comfortable and safe enough to engage with the complexities of urban society, because we can also retract in our sort of own little circles, in our own little bubbles. But it also requires a certain responsibility and duty from both designers as well as citizens. And I think that still holds for the 21st century. Let's move on. That was in the 1950s. That was theory. What does that look like in cities today? And I'm going to show you one of my favorite public spaces in the world. It's this one. I don't know if you can see it very well or if you recognize it. It's in Sao Paulo, Brazil. It's called Sesc Pompeia, and it's a leisure center that was designed by the architect Lina Bobardi. An old factory that has been deserted and that she turned, it opened in 1982, into a multifunctional leisure space. And this is me sort of going through the building. You just saw the childcare section. Now we're in the library. Over there is an art gallery. On the other side of the street is a canteen where people can eat together. There's also a sports center where people can play basketball. There is a little swimming pool where people can go out and swimming. So in that sense, it's sort of a very beautiful public space because very many functionalities are coming together and they're overlapping, right? Sort of you go to the library, but you run into people who are bringing their children to the daycare. And also in the architecture, it allows you to sort of seclude and retract yourself a little bit. You can sort of sit on your own small table, and there is even little sort of small walls around it, so you can sort of feel secluded in your own little space. But there's always these other people which are a little bit further. You can just sit down there, you can actually enjoy the space. And for me, it's a very pleasant space, and it's very vibrant. And also the way that she designed it, I think, is very much a really interesting example of public space, because she didn't just go in as an architect, as Lotte Stambeze did, which sort of was the modernist clean sheet, you know, here we go with our platform. But she went in, and this factory was actually already deserted for a while, and it had been squatted by people who were living there in the neighborhood, and people were already playing soccer there. There was a small theater group from the neighborhood that had squatted one of the spaces. So she moved in, and she actually worked with the people who were living there to help them develop in the kind of spaces that that community would need and was interested in. And as she said it herself, her definition of architecture, I think also very beautiful, she said, "For me, architecture is to see an old man or a child with a full plate of food walking elegantly across a restaurant looking for a place to sit at a communal table." Right? So for her, it was really a public space that, through its architecture, connects you with sort of the broader histories of the particular place, because people used to work there in that factory. That was still reminiscent in the way it was laid out. But it was also a place where, as a human, you could be dignified. You could walk there. You could go there for your recreation. You could go there for food. But you could do so also in a communal setting. And at that time, and still, actually, it still exists, especially at the opening, people were really enthusiastic about it. It was a great success. This is one of the reviews written by Mr. Ferras. He said, "It's an architectural experience that combines creativity with great rigor, freedom with responsibility," right? The same theme that we also saw in the work of Lotte Stambeze in the Rotterdam neighborhood, "riches with conciseness and an economy of means with poetry and ethics," right? And again, for me, I find this a very inspiring way of talking, of thinking about public space, especially this relation between freedom and responsibility that I already spoke about. Now, if this place is so successful, then you would expect that we would build a lot more of those spaces everywhere around the world. And the fact is, we don't. Actually, if you walk across the street from Cesc Pompei, you see this. A development that was built about 10, 20 years later. And it's a shopping mall, right? It's another kind of manifestation of a design of some sort of public space, private space, somewhere in the middle. And in a way, it looks a little bit like Cesc Pompei. If you go inside, it looks like a traditional shopping mall. So, of course, you have all the shops, but you also have the small restaurants, just like you have in Cesc Pompei. You have little seats where you can sit out. So, in a way, you could say this could probably also function as a public space in the same way that other place could. At the same time, I think it's radically different because it's also built on a very different underlying structure, right? The shopping mall, first of all, it doesn't really have that relation with the history that the fabric has and the leisure center. But it's also an exclusive space, right? Where Cesc Pompei is open, everybody can walk in, etc., etc. A shopping mall is not everybody is welcome in a shopping mall, right? And you cannot do anything you like in a shopping mall because there are very stringent rules, and that is related to the fact that, of course, the shopping mall needs to make a profit, right? If you look at the design principles behind how the space
is laid out. It's not so much about human dignity. It's much more about the science of shopping, right? Sort of as described by Paco Underhill, for instance. I don't know if you know his book. He's sort of an anthropologist who did a lot of research into how people shop and how they experience in shopping centers. And actually, the owners and designers of shopping centers have taken the insights from that to sort of improve their shopping centers so their profit can become higher and higher, right? And what I think, and of course you cannot blame them for them because they're entrepreneurs and they're doing shopping centers, but I think what the problem is in this example is that the way that we do our urban investment and we organize that, or our urban development, is that it comes back mostly to investment, right? So it's investors who are looking for return on their investment, which is economic, right? Which leads to shopping centers, which leads to this kind of logic in the public spaces that are there, and which leaves a lot less room for the type of public spaces designed by Lina Bobardi. And I think Saskia Sassen has written extensively about that. If you look at urbanization around the world over the last 20, 30 years, you see that actually project developers have become a lot more powerful, and architects with their visions about what public space is and how we can actually design it for the people, they've become a lot less powerful. And it has to do with mostly with our economic system and how we invest in our cities. So what I wanted to show here in this first two chapters was that successful democratic public spaces, they are open, inclusive, inviting, they connect, they combine a plurality of users and publics, and they allow both for collective action, but also for some sort of individual dwelling, right? So where you can sort of feel at home. You do not always have to be in these high-end, abstract, rational discussions with others to enjoy public space. However, I would say that our current economic paradigms for urban development do not always support those values. And of course, it's not black and white. You know, you can also experience some sort of public spaces experiences in a shopping mall, but still the underlying logic in our urban development in many places around the world, maybe it's different here in Germany, is that of return on investment for developers. And I think that's an important parallel when we talk about public space in the network society or in online networks. So I'll leave the urban right now and I'm going to move to the media world. And I'm going to look at public space and the organization of public space in the media landscape. And I'll do that in two chapters. And first I'll start with looking at newspapers, because I think that they're really an interesting example to look at, also when we compare it with what's happening through platformization and public space. And in a way, you could say that newspapers are a bit like public space because they're also a bundle of function. Of course, they bring news, but they also bring job listings, personal ads, puzzles and comics, etc., etc. And when we think of the newspaper, of course, we think about the importance of the news and the debate that's in there. But if you look at the numbers, actually, you know, before the internet, more than 40% of income for newspapers in the United States, for instance, came from classified ads, right? Sort of the little ads, three lines in the back of the newspaper that you used if you wanted to sell your car or something else. People were buying the newspaper on Saturday, maybe not only to read sort of the articles, but also for the job listings if you were looking for a job. And of course, that all came together. That was the logic of sort of the late 19th century industrialization, when the mass press started to develop sort of the first mass newspapers. The printing presses were very expensive, so it became economically sensible to actually bundle all these different things into one package. And that package was published by commercial publishers. However, I would argue that that whole system, to a certain point, was not based on only the commercial logic of the publishers, but by the professional values of the journalists, right? The journalists and their professional values always played an important part in the way that the newspaper was organized and that the editorial process was done. So You can make a long list of those. There's various studies done. Fairness is one, objectivity, transparency, impartiality. And of course, there are some discussions about that, whether, you know, should journalists always be objective or not, et cetera, et cetera. That's not the discussion that I want to have here. What I want to point out here is that here we have a system, the newspaper, where the journalists and their logic actually determine what's in the newspaper and what is not. And of course, there have been clashes between journalists and between publishers. And it doesn't the fact that you have professional values doesn't always mean that every journalist always adheres to them. But at least, as a reader, you know what the newspaper stands for. And often, if for example, you think you're not being treated fair by a journalist, you can go to an ombudsperson or to a council or to the Council for Journalism in the Netherlands, for example, and I'm sure you have something similar in Germany. So there is a whole system which safeguards the organization of public values in newspapers. If we look at that, and that was sort of media before the internet, simplified a little bit because, of course, it's more complex than that. But you could say that mediated public spaces, such as the newspaper, they've always combined various functions. And like public spaces in the cities, they had this role to exchange and confront, to bring out discursive discussions and reflection. And the production was reined by professional values, and those professional values were always related back to the function of journalism in democracy, right? And that's why journalists in society have also argued for sort of a special role or special treatment and a special status in society. Now comes in the internet, right, in the 90s. I was actually working at a newspaper myself in the 1990s. And I remember when I was there for my job interview in sort of the mid or the end 90s, the editor-in-chief said, oh, you are going to write about the internet. Well, yeah, it's probably not a fad, you know. So, you know, I was very young at that time. So he thought we have to do something with it, but he wasn't really taking it seriously. And of course, well, he has come back from that from now, because I think indeed what the rise of digital platform does is really shifting around the underlying structure of the way that we organize our information. And I will explain that. And I will do that by going a bit more into depth in the book that we wrote, or me and Thomas Poole and José van Dijk, who you see in the middle, The Platform Society. In the book, we look at platformization in different domains. We look at urban transport, health, education, and news as well. But I will focus on news today. So what we argue in the Platform Society is that we can understand platforms as multi-sided marketplaces, a bit like cities. They connect, they bring people together, connecting various sources of supply and demand. And multi-sided in this means that it's not that the marketplace is not only connecting me with a journalist or connecting me with my friend through Facebook, for instance, but it's also connecting us, me and my friend, to advertisers, right? So it's not just serving us, the people who use it, but it's also the people who are use it are also the product for another group of customers of the platform, which are, in this case, the advertisers, right? So that's very important. And again, that was also the case in traditional newspapers, right? Where also the readers were sold as readers to advertisers, but still there, starting to repeat myself now, the sort of the professional values made sure that there was a difference between those two processes. So what happens with what we describe in the book, what is interesting about what's happening on the internet with news distribution, for instance, is that this bundle of services that we were talking about, that the internet is actually a mechanism that takes that apart, right? I was just explaining before that the logic of the expensive printing press made sure that in the end of the 19th century, all those services sort of came together in this printed thing that was delivered on your doorstep every day. But the internet has a very different sort of organization and structure, so that doesn't happen anymore. So all the functions that the newspaper had are being taken apart, and mainly the ones that made sure that a lot of income came to the newspaper, like job listings or classified ads or relation ads, they all became their own services on the internet, right? So that means that the traditional newspapers lost a lot of their income because those little classifieds, they paid for the correspondent in Beijing or in Sao Paulo or the people covering the Bundestag. Of course, those sort of sites that sprung up, they could be run a lot more efficient if they didn't also have to keep up those expensive journalists. That meant a loss of income for the newspapers. But of course, I think what's more interesting or more important is that we do not only see this disaggregation, but we also see a re-aggregation. Right? If you look at the internet, then on the one hand, all those services are being spread all over, and it's not a newspaper that brings them all together anymore, but it's platforms like Google and Facebook that bring them together. And when they do so, in my Facebook feed, an item from a newspaper has the same status as the update from my neighbor, for instance, or from my nephew, right? That becomes all sort of one big stream of news. The logic that those platforms use is, of course, very different from the logic of the professional values that we found in the traditional press, right? Organizations like Facebook deliberately are saying, and they're changing a little bit. This is sort of their stance in probably like 5 years ago, saying we're not a media company, and I think they would still uphold that, although they've been under a lot of pressure, so slowly they're sort of trying to see how to deal with that. But in essential, they're saying, we're not a media company, so those professional values are completely unimportant for us. They say, we are just a particular marketplace and we do not have any values in the way that we organize that. But I would argue that that's not true. I would argue that they do have particular values, right? For instance, let's have a look at a discussion that was playing around this time. The example is from 1 or 2 months ago, right? When there was a discussion concerning the American elections, whether or not Facebook should take down lies in political ads, right? From a professional point of view, if you would feel responsible for the infrastructure, you would say, yes, of course you would do that. But Facebook would say, no, we're not doing that because we do not see ourselves responsible. And I'm not really sure if you can read it, but the letters are very small. But what Mark Zuckerberg said, for instance, is in one of the hearings that he had over the last few years, Facebook users should be allowed to make those decisions for themselves. If we don't want hate-mongering politicians, then we just must not elect them, right? So the responsibility for what happens on the platform is completely shifted to the users of the platform, right? And of course, that fits very well with the libertarian ideology in which a lot of the IT companies embrace sort of the Californian libertarian ideology. For them, that makes sense. You know, for them, it's not a fault in the system. No, the system runs actually quite well. The fault is, according to them, that the responsibility for everything is with the users and not with the designers of the system. Maybe there's something to say for that, but at the same time, they have designed the system that, because it's a multi-sided platform, really is optimized not so much for, as what Lina Bombardi would say, sort of the dignity of the old man or the child to make use of it, or for the optimization for sort of the social connections that Lotte Stambeze in the 1950s would argue for in her vision on architecture. It's really optimized to get as many clicks as possible and to get in as many advertising dollars as possible, right? So, and this is an analysis of the New York Times, and I think it's very spot on, right? They say, well, the system as it's organized, it's not neutral at all. It gives an advantage to candidates whose campaigns are good at cranking out emotionally charged, hyper-partisan content, regardless of its factual accuracy, right? And that doesn't mean that by default it's a platform that's very advantageous to sort of right-wing populists. It's just that in the current system, they are making a lot of use of of that particular feature. But you could also, you know, from a left-wing perspective. Right? So in that sense, it's agnostic in terms of its political color, but it does bring out a very particular way of relating to each other, right? So whereas the public spaces that I've shown in Brazil and in Rotterdam, where they invite actually for people to become part of larger collectives, to find a relation between sort of individual freedom and sort of collective responsibility. This system, in the way it's designed, is very much designed towards hyper-specialization and hyper-partisan way of organizing information. So, to summarize, platforms disaggregated re-aggregate mediated public spaces, but they do so under different logic, right? And what I was trying to say is that logic is highly libertarian. As facilitators, they deny having a responsibility for organizing the public sphere, right? They say the structure is not the responsibility of the designer, it's the responsibility of the user. However, at the same time, the structure does invite a particular kind of use. So for me, there's a huge conflict there. And I would argue, as a European, that indeed architects, designers, policymakers should really sort of step in there and take that responsibility. That's basically the conclusion of my story, right? I've tried to explain to you that public spaces, physical, digital, embody a central principle of democratic societies, right? Those are the places where we learn how to relate to each other, where we learn about other, where they can breed empathy, they can breed dialogue, they could also breed conflict, but they also provide sort of the mechanisms to resolve those conflicts. And of course, you know, I'm a bit idealistic. Also in public spaces, we should acknowledge that there is struggle, that there are groups that are not represented there. So we should also, of course, open our eyes for the shortcomings of traditional public spaces. But I think in general, the concept still holds. They make us feel at home in complex societies. They connect, they confront, invite dialogue, reflection. And these public spaces, they emerge from the underlying structures or the logic that facilitates their use, whether it's the shopping mall or the leisure center or Facebook or a 1950s neighborhood in Amsterdam. And I think that a lot of the current structures undermine the emergence of those public spaces. Like I said, both in urban development, I think the developer logic is too much focused on getting a profit out of buildings and out of developments, and not enough on inclusion of everybody in society, not enough on the dignity of the old man and the child, to go back to Lina Bombardi, etc. And I think, and that's sort of the point that I'm trying to make over again, that there really is a responsibility there for architects, software developers, clients, citizens, and policymakers. And maybe to close off, what I wish for is that our online public spaces, our platforms, are becoming more like Cesc Pompeii and less like the current version of Facebook, where, and I think for me this one is the most important part, where the freedom that it brings, because also platforms like Facebook, I mean, there is lots of positive things that they bring out. They really sort of can help getting people together, connect people, give people sort of freedom to choose, but they lack at this moment in time their responsibility. Thank you.
Do we have time for questions? Great. Gibt es hier ein paar dringende Fragen? Hier kommt ein Mikrofon.
Ja, schönen guten Tag. Highly interesting presentation. Thanks a lot. I've done some research on that myself. I would like to complement it with another structure. If you look at Roman law, I think you cannot look at public spaces without dividing them from private spaces. And if you look at Roman law, we had the res private, the private realm, and the res publicae, the public realm. And the public realm, the res publicae, the thing that concerns us all, like you said, was constitutive for a the Republic. Like, not only etymologically, but it sprang the Republic, it sprang democracy, the thing that concerns us all. However, it's always distinguished by this, or it's defined by this distinction between public and private spaces. I mean, the German Constitution Court has given a couple of additional spaces, like social sphere and intimate sphere, etc. So it's a little refined. But what I wanted to say is, when we look at the internet right now, we have the function of public spaces that you have, I think, have defined very, very well, and the function of private spaces, and they're going completely out of bounds. We don't have a functioning private sphere, we don't have a functioning public sphere, and I do think that this is, again, if that doesn't happen, it's constitutional for a constitutional society, for a Rechtsstaat, right? It's like, if we don't have that, and that is a political challenge to me, it's not a challenge that platforms need to meet themselves, right? Because these are economic actors. So what I'm trying to say is, like, I want to compliment, I would like to hear your comment on this, because you are missing out, you're looking at public spaces, but you're missing out on this duality between public and private spaces and how it should be for working society.
Yeah, thank you very much for that comment. I think it's very valuable, and I don't think we have time to sort of go really into depth. I would say I would agree with you. There is, of course, very many ways of looking at public. I mean, there is public sort of space or public sphere functionalities that could happen in a private space, like a shopping mall could sort of function as that, but it's not a true public space, because exactly what you were saying, it's reigned by sort of the private owners of that. And I think the point that you're making, I think that's the most important point that I hear from you, is that you find that I'm not stressing enough that it's not just a responsibility for designers, but it's actually a political thing. And I would really agree with that, right? So it's, I think I also added policymakers at the end, and I think I think in the end, we really need to change and address this through politics, right? So there I concur with you, absolutely.
Ich würde noch eine Frage mit Blick auf die Uhr zulassen. Gibt es die? Nein. But there will be a chance to talk later with you.
Absolutely.
At the coffee break and at the reception. Martin will be around. We thank you very much for your enlightening talk and your keynote and the food for thoughts.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.